A recent investigation by the Financial Times found that Ukrainian children were taken by Russia in early months of the war and put up for adoption by Russian authorities. To discuss these revelations and what it could mean for Russia, I'm joined by Wayne Jordash, president of Global Rights Compliance and International Humanitarian Law Firm. Let's start from the beginning. What did this latest investigation reveal about what happened to these Ukrainian children?
There is a pattern of children being abducted into Russia or into occupied parts of Ukraine by the Russian military. Evidence shows that there are three broad scenarios. One is where the Russians occupy a particular piece of territory and they empty the orphanages and they take the children into Russia. There are scenarios where adults are separated from their children during security screening, so-called filtration by the Russian military. And then there are examples of children being separated during armed conflict. And again, those children ending up in Russian-occupied territory or in Russia itself.
And we reported last year that some 20,000 Ukrainian children were forcibly deported to Russia or Russian-controlled parts of Ukraine, as you say. You're based in Ukraine now. Have you heard any stories or worked on any cases like this?
My organization consists of national and foreign prosecutors and investigators, and we support the prosecution, the prosecutor's office, and they have a juvenile justice division which is focused on these deportations. In fact, their main investigation is into these deportations. So what they do is essentially try to find out where children are, and when they find them, try to recover them and also document deportations more generally.
How difficult is this process to both, you know, find information on these children, but also to get them back?
For these crimes, what you have to investigate is how the children, first of all, went missing, who took them, how they were transported through Ukrainian territory, and where did they end up, which means you have to have access to both the Ukrainian-held territory, the occupied territory often, and most difficult of all is, of course, having access to Russia, which involves essentially having intelligence there or open source investigations there. So these are really difficult investigations, which is why actually you mentioned 20,000, but it could be significantly more than that.
When you're able to find these children, how are they returned back home? What is that process like?
Many of the children are recovered because of the courage of the parents who find out through informal sources, or these NGOs who find out through informal sources where the child is. And then through efforts, whether that's traveling to Russia, through Moscow and to the so-called summer camps where they're held, or to the adoption stations where they're held, and demanding their return. You're talking about a fairly ad hoc system, which is why, even though you've had 10,000 children abducted, tens of thousands of children abducted, you only have several hundred which have been recovered.
Wayne, are these children still being abducted, or is this something that happened only in the early months of the war?
Oh, it's still happening. I think it's happening less now, essentially because the front lines are more stable. So efforts can be made to protect children, efforts can be made to protect civilians more generally. But of course, that's not always true.
As we speak, there's evidence that's ahead of the International Criminal Court for other alleged war crimes. How does this evidence of forcible displacement fit into that larger landscape of evidence that's being presented to the ICC?
Well, the ICC has issued four arrest warrants. Two are for the abduction of children, and two are for indiscriminate shelling of civilian infrastructure. And I think what links all the crimes by the Russian military together is a system which is designed essentially to target civilians, with the main objective being to force them to capitulate. And also what that means is capitulate and adopt Russian identity. This is often why the children are being abducted, because they arrive in Russia and then are subjected to indoctrination. They go into so-called summer camps. They go to schools where the educational curriculum is really just military indoctrination or indoctrination about Russia and its imperialistic grandeur.
You mentioned, unfortunately, that there's precedent for this type of crime involving the displacement or taking of children. What are some of these other examples where we've seen this in the recent past?
I think the best example, actually, the one that resonates with me, is the theft of children by the Nazis from German-occupied territory, for example, in Poland, where there's a process of essentially taking children to Germanize them and turn them into loyal German citizens. But children stolen effectively because they represent the ideal of German Aryan Nazi theology or ideology. And so that's what you see here. Ukrainians are a choice from the Russian military and the Kremlin because they suit the population, because they can be instituted into Russian society and fulfill a population depletion problem. So it's both a population issue and a Nazism type of superiority ideology underpinning this.
In this landscape where there's a lot of conversation about holding Russia accountable, who would hold Russia accountable for these allegations of war crimes, and how would it be enforced?
There's no silver bullet here. I mean, the International Criminal Court, which we've mentioned, will only look to investigate and prosecute a handful of Russian senior leaders. The Ukrainian Prosecutor General's office is trying to prosecute on a national level, but of course, they don't have possession or custody of most of the suspects, only low-level prisoners of war. And then you have third countries who can investigate and prosecute using universal jurisdiction principles, i.e. when they're really serious crimes, they can be tried anywhere. But effectively, this web of accountability is as good as it gets, and it's not actually very good.
Wayne Jordash, President of Global Rights Compliance, thank you so much for having this conversation with me.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And for PBS News, I'm Yasmin Sami Alamiri.